the book education. And this quote I have referred to on many occasions. The book education, page 262. And this is what it states. It says, millions upon millions have never so much as heard of God or his love revealed in Christ. When you think of all of the people who live in Orlando, and when you drive up and down the highways at rush hour, I mean, people, have they heard of Jesus? So millions upon millions. Catch this. It is their right to receive this knowledge. Is their right to receive this knowledge? Catch this next point. They have an equal right, an equal claim with us in the Savior's mercy, and it rests with us who have received the knowledge to impart and answer their cry. That touches my heart. It says, it is their right to receive this knowledge and an equal claim in the Savior's mercy. We have been blessed. We have the privilege of knowing Jesus, and they have that equal right. And it rests with us to share. There's another quote, which I have just read last night, I think it was. If I can quickly find it here. I may have to come back to it. But the quote states that we, at this point in Earth's history, are to be sharing God's word like the least of all them. And that is what you are doing through your ministry at Renegades. You are sharing, you are placing tracts, you are placing literature, you are witnessing, you are present. And that is what God wants us to do. This morning, we're going to be sharing through a message from It Is Written, how to follow up Bible study interest. Terry says you have 11 studies going on right now. That is awesome. You have a literature array of materials. You have various tracts and various things that you are handing out, drawing attention to God's Word. And as it is through a follow-up mechanism that success. Now, you all know Ron Halvorson.
Yes.
Ron Halvorson did the series of meetings in October of 2013 in Charlotte. Following Christmas time, I was down at his home in Crystal River. And we were out in the boat because Ron loved his boat. And we were out there for a couple hours, reminiscing over the meetings and the excitement of what took place. And Ron says, we as a church are good at building bridges. Cooking schools, community service centers, health clinics, all types of bridge building events that we're good in because we are out there trying to witness, trying to share. But Ron says this, we do a very poor job at bringing people across the bridge to the baptismal tank. We're good at the events, but we're not good with the follow-up. Now, it is my understanding, and shortly you're going to be doing a mass mailing here in the community someplace. And as these cards, these interest cards come in, you have product at the flea market where cards are coming in, interest names are coming in. What do we do with them? What is the best method? What is the ideal method? And we're going to share by video from It Is Written in two parts how to follow up these names. So I think if we're ready, we will play.
Hello, this is Yves Monnier, and today's presentation is entitled Following Up Bible Study Request Cards, Part 1. What happens now that the Bible Study Request Cards have been mailed out in your community? Well, what happens now is that you simply wait for the responses to come in. Actually, in addition to just waiting, this is a good time to go over some important checklist items. So, number one, what you can do is pray that God will impress many people to send cards back requesting Bible studies. Pray also, as Jesus instructed in the Gospels, that there will be laborers ready to gather the harvest. So, pray. That's number one. Number two, as you wait for the responses to come in, and this is now talking about laborers, make sure that your evangelism team is ready to respond to the requests that soon will be arriving. You don't want any delay. As soon as the cards come in, as soon as they arrive, you want to go to these people's homes and present to them the study guides they have requested. I have seen this happen way too many times, that cards come in and then nothing happens. They just are placed in the corner somewhere, and finally someone remembers about the cards. Maybe it's a question of disorganization or just forgetfulness, but it often happens. And when finally these cards are followed up, way too late, what happens is when you go to the person's home, they will say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm no longer interested. Or I've done something else and this is not something I'm interested in doing anymore. So the window of opportunity, we must understand this, the window of opportunity is only open for so long. So it is important to follow up these cards as soon as possible. And so I highly recommend that you gather your team. Maybe it's just one other person, maybe two other people, but you gather your team, you meet regularly to pray, like I've said earlier, and to plan and prepare so that when the cards arrive, you'll be able to visit these people, respond to them immediately. What else do you do as you wait for the cards to come in? Well, make sure that your supplies are ready. Let's look at the chart here so you know exactly how much you need. If you've done a mailing of 1,000, you want to make sure that you have 20 each of lessons 1 through 5, and then 15 complete sets. If you've done a mailing of 2,000, you want to have 30 each of lessons 1 through 5, and then in addition, 10 complete sets. If you've done a mailing of 3,000, you want to have 40 each of lessons 1 through 5, and 15 complete sets. Well, you get the picture here. Look carefully at this chart and make sure that your supplies match. So, looking at the last number here on the chart, if you've mailed out 10,000 cards, make sure that you have 140 each of lessons 1 through 5 and 50 complete sets. This is very important that you are ready with your supplies. And in order to order your supplies, you need to call our toll-free number, and it is 888-664-5573. Just call It Is Written's customer service department, and they will make sure that your order is taken care of promptly. While you're waiting for the cards to return, here's what you need to do also, and that is number 4. So that you're well acquainted with the lessons, I recommend that you do the lessons yourselves. So as you make an order for all the supplies, make sure that you order for yourself a complete set. That will be your set. And that you pull out the lessons and you do the lessons yourself. It is important for you to know what lesson 1 is about, lesson 2, lesson 3, so that when you go to the people's homes, you know what you're talking about. Number 5, you may or may not want to do this, but I think it would be helpful, and that is set up a video orientation with It Is Written. In other words, set up a time when we at It Is Written, and more than likely it will be someone in the evangelism department, we will meet with you by video conference. So it could be a small group, it could be for a prayer meeting, it could be during the afternoon on Sabbath, but we are eager to meet with you, to discuss things with you, to share some thoughts, make some observations, and give you the opportunity to ask questions. Whenever we've done that, it's gone extremely well. People have appreciated It Is Written connecting directly and the opportunity to ask questions and for us to do our very best to give you the appropriate answers. So number 5, as you wait for the cards to come back, maybe set up a video conference with us. It could be something that you will greatly appreciate. Number 6, maybe I've repeated myself, but I'll say it again, pray. Pray some more. There's something about the power of prayer. Prayer changes things. Prayer is a game changer. So while you're waiting for the cards, just continue to just pray. Number 7, trust that God will do His part. You've done your part. You've prayed, you've done the mailing, you have the supplies, you've gone over the lessons, you've met with your team, you've done all of those things. Now trust that God will do His part, that God will touch the hearts of people out there who will be receiving the mailer, and that they will be impressed by God to respond and send the mailer back in. God knows what He is doing. And now, slowly but surely, cards will start arriving, and we can say praise God to that. According to past experience, you probably can expect a response rate of about 5 to 10 per thousand. And when you start receiving those cards, let me tell you, it is absolutely exciting. I know that for us here at It Is Written, it is exciting because the cards come into our office and we see them, we look at them, we praise God for them. So it is exciting for us and it will be exciting for you as well. As they come in, you will greatly rejoice. Now, remember one thing. Each of these cards, and I'm going to pull one out here so you can see it, but each of these cards, this here is a blank one, but each of these cards represents a person, represents a soul who is seeking for answers. These cards, let me tell you, need to be treated with the utmost respect. They have the highest value. This here is gold. By the way, before I go on, let me just quickly explain to you the whole mailing process. And let's use the name of a lady, let's call her Betty Brown, okay? So Betty Brown receives a mailer just like this one here. She receives it. She looks at it. And as a result of our prayers, she's impressed that she wants to respond to this. She wants to learn more about the Bible and prophecy. She wants to understand the truth about hell. And she wants to know better what's in the future. And of course, the Bible has all the answers. And so there she has this card. She fills it out. She tears it off. And as simply as this, she places this card in the mailbox. The mail, United States Mailing Service takes care of the rest. Where does this card go? It goes to P.O. Box 6 in Chattanooga. And so it comes into our office, and there in our office, we sort all through these cards, and we rejoice, like I said, for all of them that come in. Well, what do we do from there? We scan each of these cards to make sure that we have a copy of the original. If something were to happen to this original, it would be terrible if it were lost. Why? Because each of these cards represents a soul, and the last thing we want to do is lose any of these cards. So we scan them so that we have a copy. What do we do with the original? Well, the original is sent right back to you. The original is extremely important because the original you will be using when you go to the person's door. So the original always goes back to the group, to the church that has arranged for the mailing. Now, some of you may be wondering, how do you know where the cards should be mailed? Well, on each card, there is a special code that has been printed specifically for your church, specifically for your group. So when we see this code, we know that it goes to you. When we see another code, it goes to another group, another church. So that's how we sort through all these cards. Now, the big question is, what do I do with the cards that we have received back? They keep coming and they keep coming. What do I do? Well, it's pretty simple what you do. You follow them up. Now, the natural response for people is to say, who, me? Maybe you sound a little bit like Moses. Who, me? Are you serious? I'm supposed to follow these up? I can't do that. Can't I just simply mail the lessons to them? No. You don't want to mail the lessons to them. The power here is the personal contact, is you connecting directly with these people and they connecting directly with you. You look into their eyes and they look into your eyes, and something happens there that can never happen through mail. And so, yes, you. Now you say, I don't have training. I don't know how to talk. I don't know how to do this. I don't know what to say. Well, here's my response to you. If you make yourself available to God for this holy service, for this holy work, the Holy Spirit will take care of everything. Let me read something from Acts of the Apostles, page 50. This is such an encouraging quote. The promise of the Holy Spirit is not limited to any age or to any race. Christ declared that the divine influence of His Spirit was to be with His followers unto the end. From the day of Pentecost to the present time, the Comforter has been sent out to all who have yielded themselves fully to the Lord and to His service. Did you notice this? This is important. Who have yielded themselves fully to the Lord and to His service. And I believe that you are doing that. To all, I continue reading, to all who have accepted Christ as a personal Savior, the Holy Spirit has come as a counselor, sanctifier, guide, and witness. What this essentially says, that as you have completely submitted yourself to God, the Holy Spirit comes along and takes care of the rest. He will work through you. In Matthew chapter 10, verses 19 and 20, I read, "But when they deliver you up, do not worry about how or what you should speak, for it will be given to you in that hour what you should speak. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. Be assured that where God calls, He provides." Friends, I realize that the text may be talking about a different type of situation, but I do believe that it applies here as well. That as you go in the front lines for the Lord, as you interact with seeking and searching people, that indeed God will speak through you. Now you're ready to respond to Betty Brown's card. And there it is. She has sent this card, and you're ready to go to her house. Here are some of the steps to follow. Number one, make sure that you've personally done the lesson that you're delivering. So in this case, it would be lesson number one. So make sure that you've done this lesson. You're well acquainted with its content because you never know what may come up. And also, when you visit with her, you can tell her with assurance, this here is an excellent lesson. Number two, make sure that you go with a visiting partner. 2 by 2. It's the wisest thing to do for many reasons. Just trust me, it's a good thing to do. And furthermore, and more importantly, it's what the Bible teaches. So as you have a visiting partner, decide ahead of time who's going to do the talking. Because the last thing you want to have happen is two people trying to talk, two people trying to lead in the visit. So one person does the talking, one person does the leading out in the visit, and what does the other do? The other one may think, well, I'm really not needed. Oh, you're so wrong. You're very, very important. Of course, you interact when there's an opportunity to interact. If someone asks you a question, of course you want to answer, but your primary role is in your heart to pray that God's Holy Spirit will be present and will guide and direct the entire visit. So that's what the second person does. So before you go, make sure there's two of you and make sure that it's decided who will be leading out in the visit and who will be doing the prayer in the heart. Number three, dress for success. I don't think you need a tie or a suit. I would say that if you went to someone's door with a tie and a suit and you're formally dressed, this might be a little intimidating. Imagine someone opens a door and sees two people just so formally dressed. It's like, oh, what did I do? Is this some investigation of sort? No. So dress maybe a little down, business casual would be good, but always remember as you plan and prepare your attire that you are official representatives of Jesus Christ. Number four, have lesson number one ready. So you've got lesson one right here in your hand, but not only do you want to have lesson one in your hands, but you want to have the actual card that Betty Brown has sent in. And that's very important because that's your ticket to this house. Because as the visit starts, you want to show this card and Betty Brown will say, oh yeah, I remember sending this card in. By the way, in addition to just one lesson, one you may want to bring maybe two or three others, and the extra ones could be held by your partner in visit. So they could have the other extra ones with them. Why? Hey, you never know. Because Betty Brown is there and she's all excited that you've come and you've delivered her lesson. And there may be other people present as well. They may say, hey, we're interested in this as well. So suddenly, what you expected to be one person searching and seeking may turn out to be two, three, or four. So come prepared with extras of the lesson guides as well. Number five, when you arrive at Betty Brown's address, park on the street. And don't linger in the car because people, believe it or not, people are watching. You never know. And they're always suspicious of strange cars and strangers. So park on the street, have a quick prayer. Don't linger in the car because people will think that you're staking the neighborhood and are planning your next burglary. So just quick prayer and get out of the car and head to Betty's house. Number six, walk on the sidewalk and not on the grass. It's important to be respectful of people's property. It really tells a lot about a person. Again, it's for the same reason. You never know who's watching. And if they're seen as being respectful of their property, it leaves a good first impression. Number seven, you and your partner, as you're walking towards the door, you need to be on the quiet side. This is not a time to be talking loudly or laughing or pointing at things in the neighborhood or in the yard. Remember, you never know who is watching, and first impressions are lasting impressions. So this is a time to be very reverent and focused on the task at hand. Number 8, ring the doorbell and then take a step back so that you're not hugging the door. You know, when someone opens the door, you don't want to be right smack in front of them. So give a little space between the door and yourself. We don't want to come across as overly aggressive. Number 9, in your heart, pray quietly as you wait for the door to open. Pray that God will guide and direct your visit. And I'm sure that as you're waiting for the door to open, your heart is beating fast. Put-um, put-um, put-um. Trust that God will give you just the right words, just as he did with Moses, who also was very nervous to be used by God in front of people. I think some of the things I shared with you are just plain and simply common sense. So if I miss something, just remember this. God has given you a special gift, and it's called common sense. Just use common sense as you plan and prepare to respond to the cards that have been mailed in, and now you're ready to deliver the lessons that people are requesting. Common sense. God, give us common sense. By the way, let me interject here and tell you what the hardest thing in doing this type of work really is. And it may not be what you think it is. And it really is the hardest thing, bar none. Do you know what it is? Finding someone home. That's right. That's the hardest thing. You go to the person's home, you psych yourself up, you're ready, you've prepared everything, you've checked everything, all is in place, you walk to the door, you ring the doorbell, and you wait, and you pray, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait, and no one answers. It really is a letdown. And so once the person opens the door, when someone opens the door, half the battle is behind you. It really is. Now someone is there, and now God is ready to speak through you. Amazing things happen. When you have found the person home, God will guide and direct exactly what you need to say. Let me share with you a quick testimony here, something that happened not long ago. One of our volunteers, Bible workers just like you, she had her card and she had her partner, and they went to the house and they were very nervous because they'd never done this kind of work before. It's like, oh, what am I getting myself into? What are we getting ourselves into? What's going to happen next? But they're at the door and they ring the doorbell, and part of them is saying, I hope no one answers. I hope no one answers. I'm really afraid. I hope no one answers. And no one answered. No one answered. So they walk back to the car, and there's kind of a relief. It's like, ah. But at the same time, it's like, oh, we're disappointed. We were hoping someone would answer, but no one was there. So as they're ready to get back in the car, the door opens, and someone yells, hey, are you coming to see me? So these two ladies turn around, and they walk back to the door, and it's like, yes, we came here to deliver this lesson that you have requested. What happened next is really a miracle. The lady says, wow, you won't believe this. Do you know why I was not able to answer the door as soon as you rang the doorbell? No. Well, I was in the back, and I was praying. Let me tell you, I'm facing some great challenges in my life. And I was on my knees and I was saying, God, God, I need your help. Please send someone to help me out. And just as I was praying, the doorbell rang. Took me a while to get to the door. I'm not as fast as I used to, but I got there, and there you were, just about ready to leave. Can you imagine how these ladies must have felt. Oh, thank you, God. You certainly are in charge. Any fear they might have had, any concern they might have had, was gone. In front of them was a lady searching and seeking for something better. God was in charge. And God, my friends, will be in charge of all the follow-up visits that you make. You are, I guarantee you, going to experience some great miracles as well. Well, we're going to end on a cliffhanger here because I don't have time today to complete the entire how to follow up request cards. You're at the door, you've rung the doorbell, and you're waiting for the person. Now what is going to happen next? Next time, we will talk about what to say. The door opens, what are you going to say? It's important that you know what to say. So make sure that you join us next time as we do part two. In the meantime, I want you to know that the work that you have enlisted in doing is the most sacred work, and God will bless you enormously. I don't think there is anything more exciting, more wonderful than going in the front lines, connecting with people who are searching and seeking for something far better. I look forward to seeing you next time. Hi, I'm Yves Bonnier with part two of how to follow up Bible study request cards. Well, to start off, let's look at an excellent quote from a little book called The Time and the Work, page 28. Listen carefully. The leaders in God's cause, as wise generals, are to lay plans for advance moves all along the line. In their planning, they are to give special study to the work that can be done by the laity for their friends and neighbors. From door to door, his servants are to proclaim the message of salvation. The work of God in this earth can never be finished until the men and women comprising our church membership rally to the work and unite their efforts with those of ministers and church officers. It is training, education that is needed. What a great reminder. It tells us there very clearly that door-to-door work is important, that we need to be doing this work, all of us, the whole membership, but not only that, but that training and education is vital as we go forward. And that is exactly why we are doing these webinars, to help you as you do your door-to-door work, as you reach to your friends and neighbors in your community. Now, if you recall, in part one of this series, we reviewed together all the things that you needed to do as you prepare to deliver lesson number one that was requested. And I stopped, if you remember, I stopped right when we rang the doorbell, left it at a cliffhanger. Well, let's move on. But before we do, let's just quick review before we actually have the door open. So, number one, as we review, you've done the lesson so that you're well acquainted with the content. And that would be check. You've done that. Number two, you're visiting with someone else. Why? Because the Bible teaches to go two by two. And both of you know what your role is. One of you is the leader, is the one who interacts, who does the talking, and the other one is the one who does the prayer in the heart. So you're ready with your companion? Check. Number three, you are dressed for success. And that means business casual, and don't forget, with modesty. So look at what I'm wearing here. Just a nice open collared shirt, a sweater, business casual. I'm ready for the visit. Check. Number four, you have your It Is Written name tag. It Is Written is glad to provide you with the name tag. And I'm wearing one, as a matter of fact. You see the lanyard. At the end of this lanyard is the name tag. And it has the It Is Written logo and my name. And so this really makes it official. So this is something that you need as you go door to door, as you respond to people's requests for Bible studies. Check, you have that. Number five, you have lesson number one in hand and some extra ones. So there is lesson number one, you have it, and you want to have more than one. Why? Because you never know who's going to be on the other side of the door. You may have a whole family, and they may say, hey, what about us? We're interested in studying as well. So you bring some extra ones. And maybe you have your companion, your friend who's going with you, hold those lessons in their bag, and they're ready to hand them to you as needed. So you have those lesson number one and extra ones. Check. Number six, you have the actual card that was sent in. So there is the card. You have it. Of course, this one is not completed. The one that you will have is completed. You have this card with you. So you have the lesson number one. You have the card. And this card, let me tell you, is extremely important because this card is your ticket into this person's home. This is what will connect you with the person who has requested the Bible studies. So you have that card? Check. Number seven, you have parked your car on the street and are not delaying in the car. That's important. You don't want to be in the car once you pull up on the parking spot, and you don't want to just stay there and wait. You never know who's watching. So my recommendation is, once you've arrived, get out of the car and head to the door. So that's check. Number eight, you walk on the sidewalk. You walk on the sidewalk, you respect people's property, you don't cut on their lawn. Check. Number nine, you and your partner are in a prayerful mode as you approach the door. In other words, you're not talking out loud and laughing and none of those things. You have a purpose, you have a mission, and that is the person who's seeking and searching for Jesus. So check. Number 10, after ringing the doorbell, ding dong, you've taken a step back to respect the person's personal space, because there's nothing more awkward that you're standing right there at the door and they open the door and you find yourself face to face. That's awkward. So make sure you just take a step back so that that personal bubble is respected. You're doing that? Check. Number 11, as you wait for the person to answer the door, again, in your heart, you're praying. No, don't close your eyes, don't bow your heads, because that would be another interesting moment. They open the door and your heads are bowed. It's like, what are these people doing? You don't know how people may react. So pray in your heart. Keep your eyes open and be ready for the door to open and have always a bright and beautiful smile. Check. So here you are, waiting and waiting. You've rung the doorbell. And you're waiting for someone to answer. And of course, your heart is beating really fast. Put them. Now, do you remember what I said last time? The hardest part of this whole work, what is it? That's right, finding someone home. That is the hardest part of going to people's homes. If no one answers, what do? Simply go back to your car and go on your next visit. No, don't leave a lesson. No, don't leave a little note saying, hey, I stopped by. You cannot do this yet. The time has not come for you to do that yet. Once you've established a connection, once you've established a rapport, once they know you and you know them and they know your name, something is there. And so in the future, if no one's home, you might be able to say, oh, I'll just leave a note saying I stopped by, or even leave the lesson. But at this stage, when there's no connection, it's wiser to just leave nothing. Just go back to your car. Simply plan on coming back another time. And as you plan your next time, I recommend that you choose a different day of the week and probably a different time of the day as well to ensure that maybe you'll catch the person at home. Now, what if no one's home the second time? What then? Well, come back a third time. What if someone is not home a third time? Well, come back a fourth time. Now, maybe you remember, I shared the story some time ago of friends of mine who had to go back seven times, yes, seven times, to finally find the person at home they were looking for. And it was well worth it because this gentleman eventually decided to join the church. So, what's my recommendation? I guess it is keep going until you find someone home. You never know. When you find that person home, it might be worth all the effort that you've put into it. I know there's a temptation to use the United States Postal Service. I would say that's the last recourse. If it's clear you're never going to find anyone home or anyone willing to open the door, then maybe just mail the lesson with a little note. But that's the last recourse, because the whole point of the It Is Written Bible School is really connecting directly with people and building a relationship with these precious souls who you know are searching and seeking. If they were not searching and seeking, they would not have mailed a card in saying, I want to learn more about the Bible. So anyway, let's say for the sake of this presentation, that someone does answer the door. And let's say that this person's name is Betty, Betty Brown. Betty Brown is the one who received this here, received the Bible study request mailer. And Betty Brown tore off the portion here and filled out her name and contact info. She put this in the mailbox, and now you are at her home and you're ready with the lesson in hand and the card. So the door opens. What do you say now? I know some of you may say, I'm just going to be tongue-tied. I don't know what to say. Well, you will say what you have rehearsed in your heart before going to the home. And here it is. You say, good afternoon. My name is Yves Monnier, and right here with me is Darlene Jones. Darlene and I are the local It Is Written representatives. And this is a good time when you show your name tag. There it is, Yves Monnier, and Darlene will have hers, and she shows hers. And we are responding to this request that was sent in by Betty Brown, and you show the card. Are you Betty Brown? Now, you just wait there and let Betty Brown respond. By the way, the whole time that you're talking, just talk slowly, talk calmly, and just smile away, because that is what will win a person's trust and confidence. It's just a nice, congenial way to do this. So Betty Brown finally responds, and she says, yes, yes, I am Betty Brown, and yes, as I look at this card, I did send this card in. But she will also probably say something like this. She'll say, well, I thought it was going to come in the mail. This is where you can simply say, well, you know, we thought that this lesson guide was so important, and since we are the local It Is Written representatives, we just wanted to make sure to deliver to you in person. I can assure you that most people, when they hear this response, will be, oh, well, that's very nice of you. Well, thank you very much. They will be thankful and they will be gracious about it. You will see how well people respond when you simply say that. Now, this is a good time. As you've introduced yourself and Betty Brown now knows the purpose of your visit, this is a good time to show the lesson and show the different features of the lesson and say, look at the beautiful pictures of this lesson, Betty. Beautiful images, compelling content, and it has some very nice questions and answers. And you can also add this and say, you know, I've done this lesson myself, and I have certainly enjoyed it. And that's one of the reasons why you really do want to do the lesson ahead of time, so that you can actually honestly and genuinely say that. And then you can say, you know, Betty, I want to encourage you to go through this question by question, and there's blanks here where you can fill in the blank in response to the question. So gently encourage Betty to really complete this study guide. With that, you're done. Let Betty know that you would like to drop off lesson number 2 and ask her if next week at the same time, same day, would that be appropriate? And wait to see and hear what she says. More than likely she'll say, sure, that'll be fine. After she responds, wish Betty a good day and the Lord's blessing, and you walk calmly back to your car. Mission accomplished. That's it. In and out in less than 5 minutes. Now, let me ask you this. Wasn't that simple? And yes, it is that simple. And yes, it is that easy. This is the first contact. And let me tell you, you want it to be short and sweet. Remember this. People are suspicious of strangers. And you are a stranger to them. And you know that what I'm saying is true because you are suspicious of strangers. I know that I am suspicious of strangers. It's just the way we are in life today. So it is very important during this very first visit to go very easy and to first establish a rapport, to establish the beginnings of trust. Very crucial. Small talk, by the way, is fine. Just remember, use common sense. And again, stay at the door no more than 5 minutes. But what if they say, come on in, come in? No, no, don't go in. Remember, 5 minutes or less, and the best way to keep it 5 minutes or less is to stay outside. It's important to keep that first visit short. Trust me, you're building relationship. In the future, there will be opportunity for much longer visits. The first contact, short and sweet. By the way, just a thought here, a nice touch that you may want to add in addition to just the study guide, you may want to leave maybe a bookmark, a nice bookmark. You can buy this at the Adventist Book Center, just a nice bookmark. You can buy a bunch that you can use as you deliver the study guides. This is just a small, personal, and I think meaningful touch as you deliver study guides. Just a thought. Now, when you get back to your car, don't linger there. Just drive off. Just go. Why? Because Betty might be looking out the window. And again, she's like, who are these people? I mean, it was nice, but who are these people? She may be looking out the window trying to figure out who you are still. Well, it's important for us to just get in the car and drive off. And once you're out of the neighborhood, a little ways, just pull off the side of the road and pause there. It is important to stop. It's important to stop and pray. You and your partner, thank the Lord for the good first visit. Praise God that we found Betty Brown at home, and praise God for her willingness to take the study guide. And Lord, we pray that Betty will study and will review what we have given her. And so you pray for Betty and you entrust her and her family and her household into the Lord's hands. After prayer, also make any relevant notes about the visit, because it's important to have a notebook that you keep notes about the people that you're delivering Bible studies to. So you would have a page and a section for Betty Brown, and anything noteworthy, you want to write it down. Write it down then while your memory is fresh. It's important to do this because this information, when you go back next week, you review it before you go to the door, and it will help you. It will prepare you for your next visit with Betty. Every time, this is an important rule, every time you leave a home, take notes. This means that for every student you must have notes on them. And as a Bible worker, as a person who follows up Bible study requests. As a person who gives Bible studies, these notes are invaluable. They will make a huge difference. Let me give you an example. Let's say that on one of your visits with Betty, Betty mentions that her husband Bill has been sick. Well, take a note of this, mental note. As you leave the neighborhood, you pull over to the side of the road, by the way, in a safe area. Be very careful, just in a safe area, so you're not impeding in anyone's way on the street. But you pull off the side of the road, and you're writing these notes down, and you're going to want to write, Betty's husband, Bill, that's his name, is sick. And one thing you want to do also is, while you're at it, is make sure that you include Bill, Betty's husband, in your prayers. So, fast forward to the next week. Before you go into the home, before you arrive at her door, you've reviewed the notes, and you remember, oh yes, Bill has been sick, and you've been praying for Bill. I hope you have. You go to the door, and of course, small talk, but one thing you can mention and say, hey, Betty, you mentioned last week that Bill wasn't feeling well. Guess what? We've been praying for him. How's he today? Let me tell you, that will make a profound impact on Betty, especially knowing that we live in a society where this kind of interest, this kind of care, this kind of listening, because she'll say, boy, these people do listen to what I say. These types of things in today's society are mostly extinct. It will make a profound impact. These people do care. Do listen to me. Friends, this is all about building that trust and relationship with your Bible students. Let me be clear. The primary purpose of responding to these Bible study request cards is not, and you might be shocked, you might be saying, oh, Eve is speaking heresy here, but listen carefully. It is not to give Bible studies. And you say, what? It is primarily to build relationships and then to study the Bible. Put that in your head. It's all about building relationships. Once that relationship has been established, once that trust is there, the Bible study will naturally follow, and it'll be a lot easier because they will be open to hearing what the Bible says because they trust you. Sometimes we go in with the intent of sharing and proclaiming the truth, of setting people right. Yeah, that's okay. But in the process, we often burn bridges with our enthusiasm to preach the gospel. First, gain the trust, build that relationship, and then share the life-changing truths. By the way, this is the way Jesus went about it. You've heard this quote so often, Ministry of Healing, page 143. It's a good quote. It's an important quote. Here's what it says. Christ's method alone will give true success in reaching people. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. You see, he's building that trust. He's building that relationship. He showed his sympathy for them, ministered to their needs, and won their confidence. In other words, he won their trust. Then, and then only, he bade them, follow me. And that's the simple plan that we are following. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good, showed sympathy, in other words, built trust and relationship, and then he bade them follow me. That's the plan we want to follow as well. Let me tell you, in countries where God and religion are forbidden, the church has grown and has grown greatly because church members have approached others just like this. They have built relationships first, friendships first. And then they have shared the truth, the life-changing truth. And I believe that we should do the same as well. Friend, there you have it. That was the first visit. I can assure you that people who respond negatively, and that's always the fear. What if I go to someone's home and they slam the door or they yell at me or some other terrible thing? Let me tell you, let me reassure you that the people who will react negatively to your presence, to your visit, are very, very, very small. The vast majority, the absolute vast majority will be so excited, so thankful that you've taken the time to deliver the lesson to them. Remember, no more than 5 minutes, the first visit. By the way, some of these people will say, I'm so glad you're here. They'll want to spend more time with you. Resist the temptation. It's better to leave them wanting more than saying, boy, this person wouldn't leave. Important lesson to remember. Less can sometimes be more. The stories I've heard of people doing this type of work have been amazing, have been touching, have been moving, have been energizing. People just glow with excitement when they start doing this type of work, connecting with people, building relationships, delivering study guides, eventually opening the Bible. People who have done this are thrilled. It has changed their lives forever. Guess what? I look forward to hearing your stories, because someday, very soon, you will be the one saying, oh, you won't believe what happened. Here is how God is blessing me as I'm connecting with people. My friends, God bless you in your work as a missionary for Jesus.
And a little bit off sync in terms of the lip voice, but the message was there. This is a recording off from the actual presentations that's done every Tuesday evening. Some of you may not realize, but on Tuesday evening at 8 o'clock, there is a half-hour webinar that is for you. It is written back in January, I think January 12 was the first viewing of about 73 topics running all the way into towards the end of 2017 of evangelism training for churches. Take advantage of it. We have on the back table a link, information for the webinar. Make certain that you pick up that link and information so you can tune in. Now, you say 8 o'clock on Tuesday night, I'm busy, I cannot watch it. Well, guess what? You can go in anytime and review and play this. Just simply go to itiswrittenwebinars.com. Itiswrittenwebinars.com, and you can pick up any archive. John Bradshaw, Alan Parker, who is director of our SALT program, has the first two sessions on the cycle of evangelism. John Bradshaw is coming up this Tuesday, in fact, has the next presentation. So please take advantage of that as well. Now, also on the back table is this survey, and I think most of you may have seen this survey. Some of you have. This is the It Is Written survey that we use for all, prior to all of our evangelistic meetings series. When we hold a 4-week series of meetings, like we did in Chattanooga this last fall, our Bible workers use this survey form. And I think you have been using it at the flea market, Renegas, as well. It works. It is a powerful tool for seeking interest, Bible study interest. We have found on 13,000 surveys, now that's a pretty good sample, 13,000 surveys, that for every three people who complete a survey, one out of three ask for Bible studies. That's a pretty good average. In fact, Dr. Alan Parker, director of our SALT program, says, Manity says, it's almost one out of two. One out of two, almost. They complete a survey. Take advantage of this. Take a couple sheets, put them side by side, make copies of it, slice it down the middle, and use it, because we suggest that every person who comes by your booth, invite them to fill it out. Seven questions, very simple question series. One of the things which you will want to also take advantage of are the other resources it is written. Yves Bonnier is director of evangelism. At It Is Written, he's my boss. He desires that churches utilize It Is Written resources. There's a catalog back there of resources and so forth, which sharing material, various items that you can share. So take advantage of that. Also, the It Is Written Bible School, other products. There are other ways of reaching out and simply placing these. I think you have this at your
Renegas
as well. Now, it is important to use the It Is Written name. We have literally hundreds of churches all over this country who are using the It Is Written Bible School materials. It Is Written, by the way, 60 years of continued ministry last March, March versus April. But March, 60 years ago, about 3 weeks ago, was our 60-year anniversary. People all over the world have been watching It Is Written. It's very tempting to want to connect people to your church. And if you are wanting to seek maximize the response, we do not want to pre-bias them. So when the mass mailing comes out, when you do your mass mailing, you are a local It Is Written representative. Order some name tags. Make certain that you go as an It Is Written representative. If they ask who is It Is Written, just tell them it is a national, international Christian media ministry, and we serve all denominations. It's tempting, and we are proud to share that we're Seventh-day Adventists, but we do not want to bias them. We want to make certain that the Holy Spirit is the one who is there impressioning and inspiring people. So you are an It Is Written representative. Let's open it up for questions. You have watched two parts, and has that been informative?
Very.
You know, going to a door can be intimidating. To me, I can go up to any door, any person, anywhere. My wife gets, she goes nuts sometimes, because we'll go out for a walk and I'll see somebody out in the street and, you know, I go up and talk to them. That's her, not her nature. And for some of us, that's not our nature. But remember that the Holy Spirit is the one who does the speaking. I spent about a full year in literature and ministry in Boston, and that taught me real fast. You do not become frightened at a door.
have a question.
Yes.
I need to get more of the what you have in your hand there, that lesson with the card on the back.
Yes.
But I do want to have a code on there.
Yes.
Because if people take that at a doctor's office or something, everybody can hear you. Oh, sorry. If people take that at a doctor's office or hospital and they get mailed in, we're not going to, it is written, we'll not know who to send it to, and we'll never have the card back. So how can I get more of those particular, I didn't see them in the order list.
When you order, just call the 800 number.
Talk to them personally.
And you already have a code.
Oh, we do.
You're right.
Okay. Who knew?
He did.
Yeah.
I think the ones that you have at your booth already have your
code on. Okay.
And this is a sample one here.
Yeah, because we have some that say sample.
But that has already been set up. So you simply tell them Plymouth-Sorrento Church, and they will look that up in your records.
Okay.
And so you will want to order this and use it as is.
Okay.
Use it as is, because the power of it is written, the name of it is written, is powerful. Other questions? Good question. Door frights already here on questions.
No door frights.
This is good practice.
No. Say you've gone a number of times and can't reach the people at home. Would another alternative be good to try to call them and schedule an appointment time to come and deliver it?
Good question. That is tempting to want to do. Eve Meunier told about the Bible worker going back seven times. I know Phyllis, the Bible worker, very well. She's in Las Vegas. And that was in 2011 that took place, 2011. A gated community of which she had no code to get in. And Phyllis was, and her husband was so determined to not give up. They kept trying. And the only way they'd get through the gate was just to sit and wait for somebody else to go through that lived there and follow them through. Well, you can't do that at that our community at Zellwood. It's only one car at a time. But be patient. Go different times, different ways. Now, the reason you do not call is that they are expecting the lesson in the mail. They do not want to see you face to face. And it's easy, it's very easy to say, no, I'm no longer interested. Mm-hmm. And to cancel, then what are you going to do? You've got the card, but they said, no, don't come. Now, some cards will come through with a post office box. Post office box. What are you going to do? You're going to have to mail it. So when you do mail it, put in a note or another card. Put in another card. And put another card and ask them if they would be willing to give you a street address. We would like to personally mail it, personally deliver it to you. And try it that way. But if you have a street address, try never to call ahead. I have, since 2011, been representing it as written all over the United States in different parts. And I have found, even with it is written donors who I go by to say thank you, if I pre-call, what are they thinking? I'm coming for money. You know. And they'll say, no, I'm busy or whatever. Just drive by and drive by and drive by, and you'll eventually find somebody. Good question. Another question.
I
I remember going to George Vanderman meeting in Miami, Florida years and years ago. Matter of fact, about 60 years ago. And wow. He had it at Dade County Auditorium. And why I remember it, because a lady had walked to the meeting and she got hit by a car out front and died. And when I come by, just a few minutes later, her shoes are still out in the road out there. I always remember that. And it's been at least 60 years ago, this meeting he held that down there. I thought that was very interesting.
Wow. That's... Any other question? One in the back. I'm sorry. We'll catch you next.
I just wanted to know if, in the event you do have a hostile encounter, what is the protocol? What do you do? I mean, it may be rare.
I think Eve's, touched upon the rarity of that happen. However, it does happen, because it's happened to me many, many, many times. Be humble. Apologize if you've said something inappropriate, if you've come inappropriate. Ask if there's a better time that you can come, pray. I mean, just be very humble and apologetic. I'm sorry if I've said something, or come in a wrong time, inappropriately. And, just leave. I mean, do not try to stay and continue to fester that relationship.
So would it be best to keep the card and continue to pray on that?
No. You have already at the door. Deliver the lesson. And then come back the next week with lesson two, hoping that you've caught them at a better time. They have, at that moment you came, number one, they did not expect to see you. They may be dashing out the door and late for a meeting.
Had a fight with their wife.
They may have, all kinds of things. Maybe there's been a fight, husband and wife fight or whatever, children. Maybe they just received some bad news of someone ill, or, there's a thousand things that could have happened. Yeah.
Maybe someone else sent a card with their name and address and they didn't want it.
That could happen.
Oh, I know somebody who really needs.
Yeah, that could happen. That is why Eve says, "Are you Betty Brown?
Mm-hmm.
Are you Betty Brown? You're holding up. Are you Betty Brown?
Yes.
We received the card. Let her see it in her own handwriting. Because when they see it in their own handwriting, now I've had a couple of times that has happened." Someone else is sent in, for someone else. But that's a rarity. Back to you.
Yeah, I work with some of these folks at the flea market, and talking with people as they come by the booth, there's two questions that seem to come up very frequently. And one of them is, who are you? What church do you represent? That comes up an awful lot when you're talking to people. And I know it's something we don't want to predispose people toward thinking a certain way, but they ask. And you can't just ignore the question. And then the second question I get a lot is specific topics. How do you people view the state of the dead? What's this issue of the Sabbath? What do you think about some doctrinal issue? They have a specific question, and they're curious about how me as a religious person approach that, opposed to the way they might look at it. Those are the two kinds of questions I get a lot. Who are you? What church do you represent? And what do you think about X, Y, and Z?
Right. Now, remember that when you are at the booth, you are representing Plymouth-Sorrento Church.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You are there representing Plymouth-Sorrento Church. However, if they picked up a material from the display holder, and it is written display holder, and they mail in a card, they may forget which booth they actually picked that up at. And so it's good to use the it is written name and go as the it is written representative. Now, when people have asked me, what church are you? If they ask me personally, what church do you attend? I tell the truth. But more than likely, they're wanting to know who it is written is. Mm-hmm. Who is it is written?
Do you have a tract or a document?
No, it is written is an international media ministry. We serve all denominations. Mm-hmm. And that's what you say. We're on Sunday morning discovery. It's 7 o'clock in the morning, every Sunday morning. We're on Trinity Broadcasting at 1:30 every Sunday afternoon. It is an international media ministry serving all denominations. Refer them to the website, itiswritten.com. You may go to the website and refer them there for follow-up info as to who it is written is.
That's on our list of all the websites that we give out to people.
Yeah, but I was thinking it's while you're standing there and they ask that question, if you could just give them some little piece of paper that has all that information.
They will become acquainted with the ministry. Simply, you know, refer them to, because they have on the lesson, it is written website. It's on the lesson. And so refer them to the website. And tell them there's a whole archive of a lot of topics, a lot of interest. Now, coming back to, you mentioned the specific topics. You will have those questions as you begin studying.
Right,
they're covering
the lesson.
It's a great question and a great topic. As you progress through the series, that topic will come and will be covered. And so I invite you to, you know, we'll cover that topic in a future lesson.
So, you know, you gave them.
They're recording it, so we have to make sure everybody speaks to the microphone.
Not trying to make me nervous. Okay, now, we gave them the first lesson, and we come back the next week with the second lesson. So we just give them the second lesson and take back the first one to correct it?
No.
How we do?
On your way out, if you haven't seen the Bible study lessons, pick up one. The differences between the It Is Written lessons and the other media ministries that we have is the answers are in the back. We used to use Search for Certainty. That was a Mark Finley product, and It Is Written still carries that product. Search for Certainty is a very effective 30-lesson series. And of all our evangelistic series, we use that until we have come out with a new It Is Written. And Search for Certainty, you had to collect the lessons and do the grading and return. No, that is theirs to keep. So when you delivered lesson one, why, that is theirs. When you go back on the second visit, you might mention how they enjoyed it. You know, was it informative to them? And I have come to deliver lesson number two. Again, we recommend even on lesson two and three and four, so do not linger. Do not be tempted to go in the home. You're simply to deliver the lesson, and that is your role. So you do not need to pick it up. We want them to refer back to it. And use it as they desire. We need to wrap up. Is there one more question? I have a church board to attend in just a few minutes in south of Orlando.
Oh, no.
So let's have a word of prayer. And if you have some questions as we pack up, why, please feel free to ask. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the privilege of service. We thank you for the opportunity of service to be able to share Jesus with others. And as this church has made a commitment in its outreach, we pray your special blessing upon every person here this morning, everyone who is involved in Arinica's outreach ministry. We ask that you would just lead and direct and guide, that the right message would be given, the right words will be spoken. And we thank you for what will be done through the energy, the efforts of each person here. And we praise you. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.